So you're looking for a review of nomenclature, right? Okay. Maybe you didn't learn in the first place. Maybe you're brushing up for the chem final. You've come to the right place. Give me 10 minutes and we're going to review it all. All of it.
Now listen, this is just a review of nomenclature. We are in no way going to teach you nomenclature in like 10 minutes. 15 minutes, 10 minutes, we'll find out. If you haven't learned nomenclature yet, check out my other videos. I got a ton of them.
Now I know this can be kind of intimidating. You're going to need some motivation, so I brought along Shy. Every now and then, if I think you need some motivation, I'll kick over to Shy. Right, Shy?
Some people dream of success while you're going to wake up and work hard at it. Nothing is impossible.
Yeah.
So step number one, know your ions. This is pretty much the biggest problem students have. But once you know your ions, that's half the battle.
Now we know.
And knowing is half the battle.
Of course, everything, I guess, is half the battle.
G.I. Joe.
Step number two, be able to differentiate the three types of compounds. We'll talk about those. And then step number three, make sure you know the rules for each of the compounds. And that's it. So let's go. Let's learn.
Don't let your dreams be dreams. Yesterday, you said tomorrow. So just do it. Make your dreams come true.
As I said, step number one is know your ions. Okay, there's no way around this. I would say 75% of the problems people have with nomenclature just comes down to not using their ions correctly. So with your cations, right? Now, some of them you don't have to memorize. The first two families, you don't have to worry about what their charge is. You can figure that out from the periodic table. Hopefully, you've studied valence electrons by now. The first family has one, the second family has two. So by losing them, they get plus one charge or plus two charge, respectively. So when we have ions from those families, we can just say lithium ion, you know the charge, or calcium ion, you know the charge. Now, where it gets tricky is beyond the alkaline earth metals. Okay, beyond that, we have a lot of multiple charges. And so you really need to be able to recognize these metals and know which ones have multiple charges. For instance, tin has two, plus two and plus four. All right, and again, it's that easy. You can just say tin two and tin four using Roman numerals. Or you can use the old school names, stannous or stannic. Now, I'll be honest, the old school names are pretty cool, but they're also pretty annoying. Once you have the stock system name, it's fine, okay? The old school names don't even cover all the charges available anyway to many of these. So, you know, we're stuck with them, but that's life. Again, you should at least be able to recognize your multiple charge cations. All right, so for instance, take these two down here. Okay, which one of these contains a multiple charge cation? Which one needs to be named differently? Do you know? I do.
Just do it!
Anions. Okay, I got good news and bad news about anions. The monatomic anions are pretty easy, right? There are no multiple charge monatomic anions. Yay! All right, and then you can get used to the endings very quickly. We change the ending to ide, which is sort of the period at the end of the chemical sentence, right? Sodium chloride, you know that's a compound. Sodium chlorine, I guess that's just a shopping list. A very dangerous shopping list. All right. So anyway, oxygen becomes oxide, charge from the periodic table. Again, halogens minus one, chalcogens minus two, nictogens minus three. The bad news about anions is that it contains most of our polyatomics. All right, polyatomics are the bane of the introductory chemistry student. Like the multiple charge cations, this is something you really should just take the time to memorize. Just do it.
No, what are you waiting for? Do it!
Really, all you have to do is memorize the eights. Each one has a different number of oxygens and a different charge. Now, there are patterns of the periodic table that your teacher may or may not teach you, or you can look up on your own, or you can just, you know, rote memorization. So your base charge is eight, for instance, chlorate, okay, ClO3 minus. Now, you can scale the number of oxygens. If I add another oxygen onto it, I get per eight. That just changes the number of oxygens by one up. That's it, charge doesn't change. Take an oxygen away, it's chlorite, all right? Minus one oxygen. And you can take two oxygens away sometimes, and then you can get hypochlorite. So those are the names. Per eight, one more oxygen, eight, stock model, ite, one less oxygen, hypoite, two less oxygen. Hey, don't forget that charge doesn't change when you change the number of oxygens. There are some tricky polyatomics. First, the two ninjas, I like to call them, peroxide and mercury one. The reason I call them ninjas is they don't really look like a classic polyatomic. Most polyatomics contain more than one element. These don't. So just like any true polyatomic, these subscripts are stuck. You can't change them. You can't reduce them or cancel them out or anything like that. Just like the four with a sulfate, never, never, never break up your polyatomics. And that includes these two. Now, the good news is you don't run into peroxide and mercury one very often. You do run into bi and thio a lot, though. It's very common for a student to see the bi prefix and think that you have two of them, but that's not the case. Bi simply means that we've added hydrogen onto an existing polyatomic, and with it, we've soaked up one of the negative charges. So for instance, okay, carbonate is CO3 2-. If I add an H plus to it, I get bicarbonate, all right? So think of sodium bicarbonate baking soda. Now, notice that the charge went down one because the H plus soaked up one of the charges. So pretty straightforward. Thio simply means we've taken an O2 minus and swapped it out with an S2 minus. But the charge doesn't change because those two ions have the same charge. So think of, for instance, thiosulfate, classic, right? Sulfate is SO4 2-. You've got that memorized, right? Okay, and so I'm gonna take away one of the oxygens and replace it with a sulfur, so now it becomes S2O3. Charge doesn't change. You'll get used to handling thio pretty quickly. You know what I'll do after this is I'll share my own common ion chart with you. I think it's a pretty good reference. I don't wanna brag, but you know, some people seem to like it. You let me know.
You should get to the point where anyone else would quit, and you're not gonna stop there.
Whew, that was a lot of time on ions, but it's time well spent. Once you have a neutral compound, again, not an ion, we talked about ions already. If you see a superscript, that's a charge, that's an ion, it's not a compound, go back, rewind, and name it as an ion. But if there is no charge, it's a neutral compound. And so what kind of compound is it? Now, obviously, we're not talking about elements or allotropes straight off the periodic table. You're seeing multiple elements here. So if it starts with a nonmetal, it probably ends with another nonmetal, and that's a molecular or covalent compound. We'll talk about how to name those last. If it starts with a metal, and again, probably finishing up with a nonmetal, that's an ionic compound. We'll talk about those first. Those are the most important things to be able to name. And then finally, if it starts with hydrogen and it's not something you recognize like water or something like that, it's probably an acid. Now, I like to tell my students, just assume anything that looks like an acid is an acid. We're gonna assume that's aqueous, that means dissolved in water. That way, students aren't trying to figure out whether to name this as an acid or just an ionic compound.
Nothing is impossible!
Now let's name ionic compounds. With ionic compounds, I simply tell you what ions are present, and then you figure out the formula. I never tell you subscripts. So for instance, if I said calcium chloride, right? Well, it's up to you to realize that calcium has a +2 charge, chloride has a -1 charge, and so I'll need 2 chlorides to balance out the calcium. So aluminum has a +3 charge, sulfide has a -2 charge, so I'd need 2 +3s to balance out 3 -2s. Aluminum sulfide would be Al2S3. I don't tell you the subscripts, you're smart enough to figure them out. So remember, any numbers in an ionic compound indicate the charge of a multiple charge cation present. Oftentimes you won't see any numbers at all because there aren't any multiple charge cations. For instance, sodium chloride, that's all you need to figure out that the formula is NaCl. But I can't just say copper chloride. There are 2 versions of copper, so I have to tell you which one. Is it copper 1 or copper 2? Copper 1, 1 copper, 1 chloride. Copper 2, 1 copper 2, and 2 chlorides. Again, copper 2 doesn't mean I have 2 coppers. It means the charge on copper is +2.
Just do it!
Listen, there's one mistake students always do with polyatomics, and that's forget parentheses when they're needed. We want to make sure that when we're adding new subscripts, because we need multiple polyatomics, that the new subscripts don't get confused with the subscripts that are already there, or worse, the subscripts that aren't there. So for instance, sodium hydroxide, 1 sodium, 1 hydroxide, 1 of each. With magnesium hydroxide, I have 2 hydroxides. And so I need parentheses there to show that I have 2 of those hydroxides. Without those parentheses, it looks like OH2, and that's not what we want to see. Even ammonium hydroxide, I need those parentheses there to show that I have 2 ammoniums, not 42 hydrogens. So watch out for that mistake.
Just do it!
Hanging in there? You doing okay? Great. Let's move on to naming acids, which is really a celebration of just naming ionic compounds. Naming acids is easy if you understand your polyatomics. In fact, I would say acid nomenclature is really a litmus test of whether you understand ions or not. If you can't name acids, it's usually because you're messing up your polyatomics. So let's take a look. Acids are very straightforward. They're really essentially ionic compounds in water, and the cation is always H+. The number of H+ ions you need are equal to the charge of the anions. So sulfate has a -2 charge. I need 2 hydrogens there. Something like chloride only has a -1 charge, so I only need 1 hydrogen there. So just ask yourself, does this acid contain oxygen? If it doesn't, then you're gonna use the hydro-whatever-ic acid format. And if you forget this, just reverse engineer hydrochloric acid. We all know hydrochloric acid. So chloride has a -1 charge, so I'll need 1 hydrogen, hydrochloric acid.
S2 minus, I'll need two hydrogens, but it would just be called hydrosulfuric acid. If your acid does contain oxygen, again, this just reflects on the polyatomic it came from. If your polyatomic contained 8, then all you do is you change the suffix to ic acid. So chlorate becomes chloric acid. That negative one charge needed one hydrogen. Even if it was perchloric acid, again, it would just be HClO4, okay? Nothing changes about the prefixes, just the suffix changes to ic acid. That's it. If you have an ite polyatomic, same thing except the ending of the acid becomes us acid. So hypochlorite, for instance, would become hypochlorous. Ite becomes us. Easy way to remember this, I ate something icky. Sprite is delicious. Don't drink pop, it's like liquid candy.
Yes, you can! Just do it!
Hey, congratulations, we're at the anticlimactic ending of nomenclature, and that's just the idea of molecular covalent compounds. The most important thing to understand about molecular compounds are they are radically different than ionic compounds. Ionic compounds form giant crystal lattices of opposite charges, forming giant superstructures that we represent by empirical formulas. Covalent compounds share their way to a full outer shell, so there are no ions. They exist as discrete, independent molecules. And the nomenclature needs to reflect that. Since we don't have ions, we can't use any of the rules for ionic compounds. We have to come up with a brand new nomenclature system from scratch. Fortunately, it's quite easy. Just remember, in ionic compounds, numbers indicated charge. We never told you the amount. The exact opposite rule is true with molecular compounds. We never tell you the charge because there is no charge. So to do molecular compounds correctly, you just have to know your prefixes. There's only one slight wrinkle in molecular nomenclature, and that is if we only have one of the first one, we drop mono. An easy way to remember this is think of carbon monoxide versus carbon dioxide. I say mono here because it's the second one, but I don't say mono here. So carbon monoxide versus carbon dioxide. And that's it. That's a pretty concise review of everything I know about nomenclature. If this helps you out, please like and subscribe to the channel. Share it with your friends. Share it with your chem teacher. All right, unless I'm your chem teacher, I already know the video exists. Thanks for watching. Have a good day.
If you're tired of starting over, stop giving up.